Hello,
Soraya. This is Jeff.
Hello.
So, this is episode number 3, and our first with a guest.
Yes,
so.
Okay.
Are you ready to get this started?
Yep.
Let's do this.
Go. Hi, this is Soraya.
And this is Jeff.
Our podcast is called Paisley Sage, Raspberry, and Rhyme.
A podcast where the two of us play music that we like and share anecdotes and background about the tunes.
We hope you'll join our conversation. And without further ado, a grubiar.
Let's get groovy. All right, Soraya, how about you introduce our first guest on the show?
Absolutely. So today, dear listeners, we have, honestly, a real, real treat. And this was the first person that we wanted to be the guest, and for a lot of reasons. So let me give you a little background about Lina Litonjua. So first of all, we got to talk about the fact that Lina is, I consider her just this real great resource, because she knows all the sides, right, of this, not only of this Paisley Underground story, but just of the music scene in general, because she's been in it. One, as a musician, as a bassist. Two, on the other side, around artists and groups and managing. But also, Lina is extremely creative, an amazing storyteller. She also co-hosts a show with Michael Curcio on Luxuria Radio, the Michael Curcio Paisley Underground Consortium,
right,
as well as doing solo shows, Saturday night specials with 70s music, also connected to other groups like the Long Riders, the Last. But above all else, she's a friend to both Jeff and I, and I consider her my spiritual comadre.
Nice.
Ladies and gentlemen, Lina Litonjua.
Thank you. That is such a great introduction. Thank you, thank you, thank you. And yes, you are right. You are my spiritual comadre. Yeah.
And you can, if anyone doesn't know what a comadre is, just go to our Facebook page, put it in the comments, and I'll reply. But Lina, it's a real honor and just a wonderful thing to have you on the podcast.
Well, thank you. I mean, I feel very honored that I'm your first guest.
Yeah, like Soraya said, you were the first person that we wanted to have. And we have a list of guests coming up, but we wanted to make sure that we had you right off the bat. So we're so excited that you agreed to do this with us.
Oh, of course. Like I said, my pleasure.
Okay, Jeff. So I'm just going to start with the question that I want to ask. But Jeff, you help me out here.
Sounds good.
Okay, Lina, I've attributed the name Paisley Underground to you. But please, set us straight. If we're wrong, correct us. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Yes, I would be very happy to, because there's been different versions of the origins flying around everywhere. I mean, it's been discussed. There was an ongoing thing in Shindig magazine a few years ago, believe it or not, trying to figure out who was the one who originated it. Now, the legend is, of course, that Michael Curcio did. And while he has a very major part in it, he wasn't actually the one who coined that phrase. We'll go back in time now to May of 1982. And my band at the time was Peer Group. And one night we were rehearsing at Hully Gully Studios, which is over by Silver Lake. And we were rehearsing my brand new song called Illusion Travels by Streetcar.
Wow.
And that night I happened to bring a tape recorder so we could record it, so I could see how it sounded. I'll play for the first time with the entire band. And I'm setting that up for why it was being recorded.
Okay.
Anyway, later on after we recorded that, I just went ahead and recorded the whole rehearsal. And there was one song that we did called Box of Words. Now, also, I forgot to mention the pivotal item here was that earlier that day, I'd gone to Goodwill and purchased a red paisley dress, and I decided to wear it that night for rehearsal because Gary Jacoboli, our guitarist, has this thing against paisleys.
Oh.
Because he said that they reminded him of amoebas, and amoebas made him nervous.
Oh, that's hilarious.
And, Yeah, I love it. So, and you know, Jeff, you probably will understand this. Lots of times band members will try to, you know, bug each other by doing stuff that the other one doesn't like just because.
Yeah.
And so I thought it would be, I love Paisley, so I thought it would be amusing to wear the dress and you know, just bug him, you know, just because.
Oh, that is hilarious.
So, okay, so back to Box of Words. Now, there was a section in the middle of the song where Gary would just kind of like do like a free form, you know, talk in the middle where he would kind of look at things around him and say things like, you know, words for this, words for that, words for the rainbows cascading off a dog's eye, which was actually one of the lyrics that he used in the record, the version that we recorded. And that night, he was just kind of looking around the rehearsal room, and he turned around, looked at me, and said, words for the Paisley Underground.
Wow.
And I didn't catch it at the time, but then the next morning, I was listening back to the tape, and I caught it. And I thought, oh, wow, that sounds, you know, that's a great phrase. And at the time, Michael and I were kind of hosting a few friends kind of every week, where they would come over either to his place or usually my place because it was a bigger room. And we'd play 60s records and light incense and wear love beads and, you know, carry flowers. It was actually pretty silly now that I think about it. But I told him, I called him up and I told him, oh, you know, Gary said this last night. This would be a great name for, you know, to call ourselves, you know, the group of friends that get together, you know, to listen to 60s records. And I guess the name must have stuck with him. And so that later on when he was interviewed and asked, you know, is there a name for this? That just kind of like flew out of his mouth. Wow. And so that's why to this day everyone attributes it to him. But he was not actually the one who coined it. It was Gary Jacoboli of the band Peer Group, the guitarist.
Wow. That's incredible.
So he is actually the one. But Michael is actually the one who named it officially, you know, just by accident. So, you know, you could say that he did name it.
Yeah.
He just didn't actually coin the words, you know, the phrase.
Right, right. So that's...
But then again, none of it would have been possible had I not worn that red Paisley dress. So right. I am ground zero.
You are.
You are the dress that launched a genre. I love it.
That's right.
I love it.
Yeah, in episode one, I compared your dress to the dress that was worn by Monica Lewinsky just because it was a dress that ended up being very influential in my world. So
I was a virgin, damn it.
I know.
I was very clean.
But see? Pure of heart, pure of soul, the dress.
The dress spoke. But unfortunately, I got rid of the dress because it was a shirt waist, and I realized I look horrible in shirt waist dresses, so I don't have it.
Well, it went off to go launch who knows what else.
Yeah.
Be somebody else's muse.
Yes. It influence still lasts today in the form of a podcast and great music.
Well, speaking of influences, Lina, we want to backtrack a little bit. And just talk to us a little bit about your introduction, maybe to the bass, but also into your groups like I.U.D and Peer Group.
Oh, wow. Okay, well, like most of the stuff I get into, it's kind of by accident. I was going to a lot of gigs, not only in Hollywood, but locally back in like the late 70s, early 80s. And I believe it was 1979, I was at a gig at the Suburban Lawn Studios in Long Beach, and they had like the greatest studio I've ever seen because it was had like two or three rooms to it. One of them was actually like a studio setup, and one of them was like I guess it was their rehearsal space, but it served as a performance area. And they had a lot of the LA bands come in and play, so it was like an actual venue also. And one night I was there with my big brother, Victor, and we saw, I think, the Reactionaries, which was pre-Minutemen, and, of course, Suburban Lawns, probably the Alley Cats. And at that night, I met Leslie and Sue Berry, who were these twin sisters who were even shorter than me. I mean, I'm only – well, at the time – I was only 5'2". I'm now, I think, 5'1". I'm shrinking.
Oh, no.
So So they were much shorter than me. I think, you know, one was 4'8", the other was 4'11". So I was an Amazon compared to them. But, you know, we became friends. And then one night, because we kept meeting up there at Suburban Lawn Studios, they said, you know what, Lina, you look great playing the bass. Why don't you join our band? We're starting a band. I said, okay. And I think they only asked that because they knew I had a bass available to me because my brother had one. And, yeah, so they knew I had a bass. So I said, okay, why not? It's like I'd never played it before, but, you know, why would that stop me? So it was just, you know, the very beginnings of the scene, and nobody was really professional level at all. Like I said, I'd never played before. And they had minimal experience themselves on their instruments. So we all kind of learned together. And we had, like, a revolving door of drummers.
That's typical, right?
It was pretty fun, though. And we would rehearse. They lived in Santa Ana. I was still living in Wilmington. So, I mean, that's why we broke up, was just not because we couldn't get along, but because it just got to be too much to try to get together for rehearsals, since, you know, we were living so far apart from each other. But, you know, it was a great fun. In fact, I think we pissed off the Go-Go's, or at least Belinda.
Oh, wow.
Because at the time, they were the only, you know, well-known all-girl punk band around. But for some reason, I don't even remember how, but Rodney Bingenheimer would also mention I.U.D. on his show, even though we didn't have a record out. We hadn't played any gigs or anything, but... Yeah, I think just because we talked to him a few times at the Starwood when he would have his DJing nights. So he was talking about us because we were actually very striking visually, obviously. And people were starting to confuse us with the Go-Go's, if you can believe that.
Wow.
And I think that must have been what maybe upset her. I don't know. But she was always picking on us, and especially me. I don't know why. So she never liked me. Jane, on the other hand, was, you know, just perfectly wonderful, and was always trying to apologize for the way Belinda was acting with us. But, you know.
Wow.
You know, girls, we can't get together. We're always so catty.
never nice when everybody wants a little bit of the spotlight. But that's an awesome story.
Yeah, that's great.
After I broke up, or we broke up, the original lineup of IUDs when I started with Peer Group, and that's, you know, how I met. Well, I was already friends with Gary Jacobly, and he introduced me to Mike Hurley, the drummer, who was also the younger brother of George Hurley of the Minutemen, and Gino Pustai. And so that's the band I played with the longest.
Wow.
And that's the one that has the records, and we did gigs and stuff, so...
Yeah, I'd definitely like to talk more about Peer Group. Is it okay if we play a song?
Sure.
So I'm going to play Lon Chaney. So the next sound that you will hear will be Lina on bass guitar. Again, this is Peer Group with Lon Chaney.
Crippled. No arms, no legs, no voice. What's your name? Lon Chaney!
Such a great song.
Thank you. Although I must apologize for that sounding so raw, since it was never meant to be released. Those were all demos. That release, that one peer group EP release, that was all supposed to be just raw demos that we, I think, did in one take.
Oh, so, is that right?
Oh my gosh, that makes it even better.
I don't know about that. But, well, but thank you anyway.
For me, it's just that I like that raw sound to it, so.
Yeah. Okay. when you're the one playing it, though, you're going, oh, God, no.
Yeah. Yeah, that's typical, right?
Yeah.
So the label Water Under the Bridge put that out in 2013, but it was originally recorded early 80s?
Yeah, that was, I believe, probably 81. Either 81, 82, because it was supposed to be originally released on the New Alliance label.
So that was
Mike Watt was supposed to put it out. And there was some sort of problem. I never really got the full story of what the problem was. He got a hold of the demos and wanted to put it out that way. And whatever was the problem never got explained to me, and it just never got put out. And part of me was relieved, so saying, oh, thank God, because I wanted to re-record them. And then, you know, but then again, we lost sight of the tape. So, but obviously he still had them, because there they are now.
Wow. So when it finally came out on the Water Under the Bridge label, the EP was called Rhetoric in Hands. Was that the title that you were originally going to release it as?
Yeah. Yeah. And wow. That was a Gary Jacobelli name. He actually did the artwork for that. He's also an artist and a writer. And even though obnoxious, just horribly obnoxious person, he is so talented that I put up with a lot of stuff. And I think a lot of people did, too. It was just because he was just like, you know, trigger finger creative, just at the drop of a hat.
Wow.
So that a lot of like the artistic stuff, that was all him.
So was that sound that we heard on that we just played from Lon Chaney, was that the kind of sound that you guys had live as well? I would imagine so, if that's a demo.
Yeah, that was, because, you know, that's how he played guitar. He didn't really play guitar like most people play guitar. And that's what left me playing bass, you know, like the melody.
Yeah, so I ended up
carrying the melody for both I.U.D. and peer group. I ended up being the melody, which is why my bass, you know, it's like I didn't realize this until much later when I saw an article about Paul McCartney's playing, is that his playing was always very melodic. With his bass playing, I guess, you know, that was kind of like what I was doing. I was carrying the melody with the bass line. So,
wow, yeah. So a lot of those songs, well, almost all those songs on the EP are all driven by your bass guitar holding down, holding down the rhythm, and Gary doing his thing on vocals, right?
Yeah. Well, we would take turns live. I personally didn't like singing because I didn't think my voice was strong enough at the time. I wasn't confident. We'll just put it that way. I could carry a tune, but I just wasn't confident enough to be a lead singer. You kind of have to have like that personality for that. But I did it. Once we lost our lead singer and became a trio, we all kind of had to take turns singing. So,
yeah, oh, wow.
There's that.
So who was the original singer?
That was Gino Pustai. The first record that we put out, that was part of the compilation Chunks. That was also a New Alliance. I saw that movie, and I think it was like exactly 1 minute long. But yeah, he was actually the one, I think it was a few months earlier, he was doing this as a one-off. The Chunks album was supposed to be like a compilation of local musicians, and he was just a singer. He didn't play anything, and he needed a band to back him up for this one track. And Gary knew me, and Gino knew Mike Hurley. And so it was just kind of like, oh, yeah, I know this bassist. Oh, yeah, I know this drummer. And we got together, and we met and recorded the track on a cassette the same day. And that's how it was supposed to be released. And then a few months later, Gino decided he wanted to do a band for real. And then that's when we all got together formally. Wow. And became peer group.
That's,
I like that.
Yeah, that's great. So did you guys...
So like, it's all by accident. Right. Everything's by accident.
Well, you know, nothing is really ever by accident. But
no,
by,
that's true.
You know, it's all very kismet, you know, how it all just happens and flows. I that's amazing.
Yeah, and it wasn't something that you had planned out to happen, but it just...
Oh, no.
It just all happened, right? So.
Yeah.
So did you guys ever...
No, I wanted to be a journalist. I wanted to be a music journalist. So on the other side of the stage.
So did Peer Group ever play with Salvation Army? Or what groups,
yes.
What groups did you play
with? Yes, we did. Actually, we played with a lot of the Paisley Underground bands. Obviously, yeah, with Salvation Army. We did our first gig at the Whiskey. And that was Salvation Army's first gig. The Alley Cats booked us, chose us, the Salvation Army and Peer Group, and also Unit 3 with Venus, who was a 9-year-old girl, and her parents and her aunt and uncle.
Oh, my gosh.
And we opened for them at the Whiskey. Yeah, I opened for a 9-year-old.
Nice.
And Salvation Army were like third billed before the Alley Cats. And then they, of course, went on and became big stars, and we just kind of disintegrated.
Wow.
But, yeah, we played with them. We opened for the Dream Syndicate at the Dancing Waters Club in San Pedro, and Salvation Army, where I think actually they were 3 o'clock by then, were also on that bill. I mean, there were so many gigs that we did together. It's like I couldn't even tell you.
Oh,
yeah,
wow.
But it was just kind of like all the local bands would always play together at either the Star Theater or, you know, each other's parties. So, you know, it was, like I said, just a hometown thing.
Wow.
We didn't think it'd get this big.
Wow. That's great. Hey, so I'd like to play another song. You mentioned the New Alliance label that D Boone and Mike Watt had, and then you also mentioned that you played with Salvation Army. So I think it's a good segue. Let's play the first Salvation Army single, and the A side was Mind Gardens, and it's by Salvation Army.
Yeah.
So, Lina, when did you and Michael meet? Was it before Salvation Army started forming, or was it, were they already a band?
It was, I think, soon after they had already formed, because I had already heard of him. I knew him as Ricky Start. This is before we peer group became a trio, and we had a lead singer who we just called him Otter, the Otter. And I was out on a date with him, and we went to it was Godzilla's in the Valley, in Sun Valley. And I remember we walked in there, and the Otter saw Michael and said, "Hey, do you want to meet Ricky Start?" And I said, "Sure," because I think at the time Rodney may have already been playing the single. I don't remember. I think it may have just been released. I'm kind of a little bit off. So it may have already been released or was just about to be released, and Rodney just happened to have the tape.
Wow.
And because I remember I already knew the song and I already knew Ricky Start. And so when he said, "You want to meet Ricky Start?" I was excited. I go, "Yeah." And so he went over, he introduced us and all that. And then he went off to do something. And I asked Michael, then Ricky, it's like, "Oh, well, how do you know the Otter?" And he said, "Oh, I've never met him before."
Oh, that is hilarious. That sounds...
Well, no, actually, he was doing it to kind of like impress me, maybe. Oh. But then as it turns out later, Michael said, "You know what? I think actually he was in my singing class at Harvard College." So that's probably, that explains that. But it was funny. It was like we ended up talking so much that night, and then we realized that we were living in towns next to each other. He was in Carson, I was in Wilmington, and we exchanged phone numbers, and he came over, he called and came over the next day, and we just started going out. We were pretty much inseparable from that point on.
Oh, wow. And you guys are still friends to this day.
Yes, we are. I mean, I ended up, he introduced me to my husband.
Oh.
So, who I, at the time it was, it's like, "Oh, Lina, you've got to meet this guy. He's in the Navy. He's home on leave." And it's like, "I don't want to meet a guy in the Navy." So I was just kind of like, whatever.
Yeah.
And he kept pressuring me to, and, so finally, it's like we all three went out together to have some tea. And I thought that my husband at the time was gay because all the guys that he kept introducing me to at the time were gay. So I just say, "Okay, he's in the Navy, must be gay." So, but no, as it turned out, he wasn't gay. So we ended up getting married. And so that's one of Michael's things that he keeps bragging about is, that he was the one who got us together. And then our children are here because of him and all that.
Wow. So who knew that Ricky Start was Cupid?
Yeah,
there you go. He was trying to pay you back for coining the movement, Lina. He was trying to give you something equal.
He gave you love.
There you go. Love. You gave him the name, he gave you love. And your daughters, there you go.
Wow.
Claim all of that.
So he's taking claim for your children, right, too, as well?
Yes, he is.
So you mentioned playing.
I just want to ask a quick question, and Jeff, I think you and I are going in the same direction. Okay, so there's a connection with Ricky Start / Michael Curcio, and then talk to us a little about your connection with Mike Watt and D Boone, or was everybody kind of in the same scene?
This is what was pretty interesting about San Pedro as it was a separate scene. Everyone kind of had a different sound. It wasn't like everyone was punk or anything like that. I mean, all the bands in Los Angeles, I mean, you had X, you had the Bags, you had the Alley Cats, even though they were a South Bay band, also they were from Lomita. But all the bands that were playing, they had the Plugs, of course, who I was working for a while. And so everyone was kind of considered punk. They might have had, a few differences, but, essentially everyone was considered punk. In San Pedro, we just kind of did our own thing, and there were some bands that sounded punk. Peer Group was considered art punk or, something arty, more arty. There was another band called The Slivers that they just made a lot of noise. And of course, like I said, there was a lot of hardcore types. And we all had just different sounds, but we all played together all the time. We knew each other. We'd travel up to L.A. together for gigs. So it was just our own scene, our own separate scene. We got some influences from the Los Angeles scene, in, you know, just knowing that, well, gee, these people don't play any better than we do. You know, we can do this too. So it was just kind of like a fun thing to do, and it just kind of got bigger. And of course, you know, the Minutemen went on to become, you know, pretty huge. So
it sounded like Mike Watt took an interest in Pure Group.
Yeah, because, yeah. Again, we were all locals. That's one thing. He's very has lots of local pride. He loves San Pedro, and so he liked to promote anyone from San Pedro.
Wow, that's great. That's so awesome. So you mentioned the Plugs. What was your role working with them?
Okay, well, I was a huge fan of theirs, and one night, I think it was like 1:30 or some ungodly hour, we somehow ended up at Tito La Riva's apartment. No, really, it was by accident. We happened to be passing by. We saw his light on. We kind of called out to him, and he said, hey, come on up. So we were up there, and he started showing me this box of unanswered fan letters that he was getting from all over the world. And I kind of said to him, you know, you really should answer these. And he said, why don't you do it? And thus, the Plugs fan club was born, and that's how I ended up working for them. When they started Fatima Records, he asked if I would come and, I guess, act as a Girl Friday. I mean, I pretty much did everything as far as, you know, I was answering phones, you know, packing records, and, of course, running the fan club from there. When they had the Better Luck record release party at the Los Angeles Press Club, I did all the catering, or yeah, I arranged everything. It's like, I think back now, it's like, I did a hell of a lot of stuff without knowing one thing about what I was doing. I just did it. But that's how it was back then. You just, you know, it's like, oh, that would be cool to do, so let's just do it.
You just figure out how you do it as you're going along?
Yeah.
I don't think there's any better way to do it. Like, I like that.
Yeah.
It just becomes really organic.
Yeah, see, like today, you think, oh, all the logistics, oh, I have to do this, have to do that. No, forget it. And then it's like, yeah, okay,
just get it done.
Yeah, just get it done.
Nice.
Tito Riva, wow, he, you know, for someone to just kind of, you know, literally in the early morning light say, hey, how about you do that? Why not? I like that. I like his attitude. But then again, I like the Plugs too, so I don't know. He can do no wrong for me. Yeah.
That's a good way to make decisions. Just executive order, it's done.
You need a colonel. You need a colonel in charge. That's right.
All right. So now let's play another song. Let's play the B-side of the Mind Garden single, the single that Mike Watt put out by Salvation Army, who then became the 3 o'clock. And then we'll talk a little bit more about the Paisley Underground and your experiences with that, Lena. But for now, let's play Happen Happened. Nice Song by Cupid.
Boy, you Pedro kids can rock.
Absolutely. Yes, we can. So, Lina, do you have any stories about the Paisley Underground since you interacted with a few of these bands?
Yes. I was actually there at the time that it started. I know a lot of the people that were, you know, like the better known people in the bands will say, well, I never saw her. I never heard of her. There was a reason for that, which I had already mentioned. I was working for the Plugs. Back then, it was an embarrassment of riches, I like to say, because the music scene then, it was just every night there would be multiple gigs that you'd want to go to all of them. I mean, there was, again, at the time, there was still the punk scene going on. And out of that was growing what became the Paisley Underground scene. And Michael and I would go to a lot of gigs together. And that's when we first started going to see when they were called the Bangs. And so, you know, he was more in tune with them, you know, as far as hanging out with them all the time. And a lot of times when they were playing, unfortunately, the Plugs would also be playing that same night. And since I was working for the Plugs, and of course I loved them anyway, I would always have to go see the Plugs, even though there was a lot of times like, I'd rather go see the Bangs, or I'd rather see the Rain Parade or something. but I couldn't be in two places at once. So that's why, you know, the Paisley Underground people will say they never saw me, is because, you know, half the time I wasn't there anyway. There was a period, I met the Rain Parade early when it still had the two Roback brothers. I have some pictures to prove it too. I believe Sue Hoffs was going out with David Roback at the time. So, and
I know that she dated Louis Gutierrez also. So was this, did she date David before Louis?
Yes. Okay. Yeah. Okay. It was before she'd met them. As a matter of fact, Sue Hoffs had tried to join the Last.
Oh.
She did. She, Joe Nolte loves to tell the story that she showed up once carrying a bottle of like his favorite booze.
That'll do it.
And left it on his doorstep with a note because she wanted to audition for the Last.
Yeah.
And of course, no girls are allowed. So of course she didn't get in there, which was, you know, a far better thing anyway.
Wow.
But, actually outside of that, because I did know the Bangs, then Michael, I said, he was more privy to what was going on behind the scenes. And he called me up one day and he said, you know, Annette's going to be quitting the Bangs and they need a bass player. And I've been talking you up and they want to talk to you.
Oh.
And so after a gig that they did up in L.A., they sat me down. I think it was actually Sue and Debbie sat me down and, you know, kind of did like the, what are your influences type of interview.
Wow.
And, you know, so it seemed to go well. And Sue said she would give me a call later on that week. So, you know, so that I could actually audition for them. Now, at the time I was still in peer group, even though we hadn't been playing, we were pretty much disintegrating by then. And I was really nervous. I thought, okay, so what if they ask me to join? What am I going to tell peer group? Or no, maybe I'm not good enough to join the Bangs, because I mean, I'd seen them play so many times and they were just amazing, incredible, amazing. It's like, am I even good enough to play with them? And so I was like, I want to join them. I don't know if I can join them. So I was going back and forth, but I still hadn't heard from Sue Hoffs. And then I get a phone call from Mike Watt, just out of the blue. And he goes, you know, Gary's pretty upset about you joining the Bangs. I was like, what the hell?
Oh,
like,
no.
How does he know? But I hadn't told anyone. I mean, Michael knew, and I may have told like a girlfriend or two, but they wouldn't have told Gary because I wasn't even sure how I was going to tell Gary.
Right.
And so, yeah, so somehow Mike Watt knew, he found out, called up Gary, told him that I had auditioned for the Bangs, and got him really upset, and then called me up to taunt me about it. And I'm like, oh my God, like, what's going on? But as it turned out, Sue Hoffs never did call me back because Annette decided not to quit at that point.
Oh.
And she stayed there, and so that's why she was in there, and I never got in there, and, you know, and there you go.
Wow, so you were that close to becoming one of the Bangles.
I was that close, yes.
Wow. How things could have turned if that happened.
Yeah, no, I don't know, Lena. Walk like an Egyptian? I don't know.
I can't see it. Yeah. I can't see that on Lena.
No. And I don't think I was cut out for touring and all that anyway, so it worked out the way it was supposed to.
Right.
So let's
play a song by the Bangles. This one I could picture Lena playing. Maybe not Walk Like an Egyptian, but maybe this one. This is How Is the Air Up There. That close to becoming a Bangle.
Yep. And that I could absolutely see you playing.
Absolutely. Yes. Yep.
Early. Yep. That EP, every single song.
Yep. That was one of my favorites too. So.
That's great.
That's my only regret, because they had such great material and everything, and yeah, I would have loved playing that, but yeah, it wasn't meant to be.
It absolutely true. Yeah. So I have a question, Lena, for you, since you are an insider and you were there from the beginning. How would you define the Paisley Underground?
Ah, well, you know, that question gets asked a lot. And like I said, people love the legend and they don't like that, the legend to be besmirched. But it really was at the time just the local Los Angeles bands, the 3 o'clock, the Bangs, Bangles, and the Rain Parade, and then Dream Syndicate. And, you know, it was like kind of after the fact, people were kind of coming into the scene, like the Long Riders. I'm very good friends with Tom Stevens of the Long Riders. And, you know, we've discussed this over and over again. And even he kind of like grudgingly agrees with me, kind of sort of, that, yeah, you know, that maybe they weren't, you know, to be considered quite original Paisley Underground. But the way I look at it, it's kind of like when the Flying Burrito Brothers came in after, you know, the Birds and all that. They weren't quite part of that original 60s, you know, psychedelia scene. But they did the country rock thing afterwards, and they were all members of the various bands there. They were all local musicians, so they were adjacent. And so I would consider a lot of the bands that came afterward, like Eyes of Mind and all that, they were definitely in that mode. But as far as the original, basic roots of the Paisley Underground, it was the 3 o'clock, the Bangles, and the Rain Parade, and then Dream Syndicate. Wow. Now, I know that Steve Wynn was trying to get into different bands. I think he actually did try out for, I think he may have tried out for the Long Riders.
Oh, wow.
But, whoa. But can you imagine him and Sid Griffin in the same band? That's why it didn't work out, because two big personalities like that in one band, it doesn't work.
I can't picture that happening.
No. I think he may have even tried out for The Last also. I mean, I can't think of anyone who hasn't tried out for The Last. But I remember, I was told, he had tried out for all these different bands, and then, he finally ended up with his own band. So, which, again, that's the way it was supposed to work out. So that's how it was.
Right. Wow.
But there's a lot of misinformation out there. I don't know how many times I've seen it, that it kind of came out of Davis, California. Not true, not true, not true. And even Danny Bonner will tell you that's not true. Obviously, he was part of it at the beginning, and so he should know. People still argue with him. It'd be people that weren't even there, that weren't even born yet, or were only like 10 years old at the time and living in the Midwest, will argue with him that, other bands, that came along, like maybe, 5-10 years later were part of it. No. And, damn it, that's my story, and I'm sticking to it because I was there.
See? We needed an eyewitness.
Yes.
And you are our eyewitness.
Nobody's paying me. I have no axe to grind except for the people who keep considering other bands that weren't there that came out of another area. Paisley Underground, no. Paisley Underground was just the style of the bands that came out of here, Los Angeles.
Right. And I can certainly see how influential those four bands were on the sound of other bands that were in the same vicinity. You can certainly hear that influence of the 60s music, even how the fashion was influenced by this music. So when you see some of the stuff that the 3 o'clock wore, some of the stuff that the Bangles wore in their wardrobe, you can see that influence in other bands that came out all over the, all over the state, all over the country, actually.
Oh, yeah, definitely, yeah.
But were they part of the Paisley Underground? No.
Influenced? They were heavily influenced. They were adjacent. They were definitely, maybe second generation.
Yep. Great way to say it.
But they were not the original tour. Yeah. Yeah.
Perfect. Thank you for that insight.
100%. See, we needed a true historian to tell us, a true storyteller, someone who lived it.
That's right. Thank you, Lina.
So, Lina, talk to us a little bit about what are the things that you're doing now? Where are your creative impulses going these days?
Well, as you mentioned at the beginning, yes, I do a radio show on luxurymusic.com with Michael Quercio of the Paisley Underground, and it is called the Michael Quercio Paisley Underground Consortium.
Highly recommended. It's highly recommended.
Oh, 100%. Sundays.
Sundays at 4 p.m. Pacific time. And I also do... every once in a while, a Saturday night special, also on luxurymusic.com, and that's on Saturday nights at 7, whenever I announce it, because it's whenever I'm in the mood to do one. And I also I have an Etsy store, and I do lots of jewelry. I'm very much into doing kind of like retro stuff, tiki stuff, monster stuff, and a lot of Dia de los Muertos. So
in October.
Yeah, I keep pretty busy.
What's the name of your Etsy store, Lina?
Yes. If you go on Etsy and just, type in Ms. Paisley's Parlor, you will find it.
Perfect. And there's some great stuff on there. I love the stuff that you make, Lina. It's
Oh, thank you. Thank you.
Very cool.
A little bit retro inspired, but also just really cool. She's got a fantastic, detailed, artistic eye. It's worth your time.
Thank you.
And talk to us a little bit about your involvement with Tiki Oasis.
We started doing that as part of Luxuria Music. They wanted some DJs from Luxuria Music to come and play. And so now we've got like a regular Saturday gig whenever they have Tiki Oasis every August. So Luxuria Music comes down and takes over the lobby for a whole day. So I go in there and do my set. And so does Rory, the band that Michael introduced me to, my husband, who is also Luxuria Music's engineer and also known as Colonel Rory whenever he does his folk show. It's a fun thing. I mean, that's how I ended up getting into the whole tiki scene, just from hanging around those people, because tiki people are happy. You know, they're always happy people. And of course, they're always drinking too, but you know, that's probably why they're happy. Yeah. But still, they're a very pleasant bunch of folks to be around. So, you know, why not?
Yeah.
And you wear muumuus. You can wear muumuus. You don't have to worry about you know, girdles and stuff. You wear muumuus.
God bless the muumuu.
Yes.
Yes. But see, everywhere. So if you listen to Luxuria Radio, and you should, luxuriaradio.com, you can find Lina, Saturday Night Special, Michael Curcio's Paisley Underground Consortium, of which Jeff and I are card-carrying members.
Oh, yes, you are.
Yeah.
You're the original consorters.
Oh, yes, ma'am. And also Colonel Rory's Folk Army, of which I've been drafted into.
Yes.
There are a lot of different shows, but also Etsy Store, Tiki Oasis. Lina, it seems like your artistic abilities have no limit.
Yes, if only my bank's... had no limit. Oh, well, maybe one of these days.
We won't talk about this.
Yeah, we won't talk about that. This is why I still have a day job.
Yes, well, don't we all?
Well, Soraya and I are so thrilled that you joined us for today's show. And we know that you have tons more stories, which is why we've tried to convince you to write a book, which I still think you should do someday.
Yes, trust me, folks.
I do still plan to, because I have plenty of live tapes of historic shows from back in the early days. So, you know, I've got plenty of material to draw from.
Yes.
Listen, if anyone listening today sees Lina at a show and you sit down with her, trust me, she's got stories in the vault, and we really want her to write a book.
Yes, we do.
She's got all these great tapes that need to be digitized. So trust me, barely scratching the surface. But Lina, thank you so much for joining us today and being our very first guest.
Woo! Oh, well, thank you. It's my infinite pleasure to be here and to talk your ear off with stories.
Yes.
So without further ado, Jeff.
Groove on, Paisley people.
Agrubiar gente, Lina Litonjua, our ultimate and most gracious thanks for being a part of the show.
Thank you, Lina.
Oh, you're welcome.
Yay, we did it!
That was fun!
Oh, Lina, trust me. I told Jeff, we gotta have her back on.
Yeah.
There's so much. And I know it was just, but this was perfect.
Yes.
This was absolutely perfect. Thank you so
much. Yeah, I think I was talking too much, but oh well.
No, it was, I think it played out perfectly.
But Lina, now I gotta ask. So, because I'm listening to that line, I can still hear that line, that bass line from Lon Chaney.
Uh-huh.
Had you played before the girls from I.U.D.?
No.
Into it?
No.
Moly.
Wow.
Like I said, it was because Victor had, it was actually Victor's bass, And I got, I had an Nikon camera, and I was going to be a photographer also. I wanted to take pictures, but he got into the photography class at Harbor, and I didn't. So he wanted me to give him my camera, and he gave me his base, and so that's what happened.
That story blows me away. I still can't believe it. That baseline is so, it's so delicious.
It is.
Wow. Lina, you're the best.
Yes.
You know, you guys are the best.